Good morning, Paradise. How y'all doing out there? For those of you who don't know me, my name is Bob. And I'm coming to you from a maximum security prison somewhere in the United States. Now, I told everybody that I was going to answer their questions, so I think I'm going to do a video every week trying to answer your questions as best I can. But first, let me address a frequently brought up subject, and that is whether or not Bob is real. You know, most of you know that I'm real. Most don't question it, but you've got the trolls out there that are always sticking their nose in other people's business because they got no life. And they've got some of you asking the same question. So, what I did was I took the camera and I filmed some bars around here. I'm not going to say the area it is, but some bars, and I also filmed my toilet, even though I've done that once before. And that's the best you're going to get. I can't show you my cell because that would identify who I am. The furnishings in every prison are unique to that prison. Same with the paint schemes. So, this is it. I'm not going to address the issue anymore. And all you trolls out there, you know, trolls remind me of dog crap. You know, when dogs crap out in the yard, what do you see all over it? You see flies landing on it and eating it. And those flies remind me, or I should say, the trolls remind me of those poop-eating flies. So, anyway, enough about that. I'm not going to recognize. That's your 15 minutes of fame. Alright, so anyway, let's see. One question that was asked of me is, how do I mentally escape being in prison? That's a good question there. I do it by many ways. Either watching TV, reading a book, listening to music, visitation. There's nothing like getting a visit to take you away from prison. And just general contact with the outside world, whether it's through writing letters or phone calls, or luckily for me, it's the internet and the phone. You know, the phone opens the outside world too. And what I've tried to do the entire time I've been incarcerated is take myself outside of in here. And I've done that through maintaining as many ties as I can with the outside world. Whether it was having girlfriends who came to visit me on a regular basis, writing letters, you know, what have you. You know, I always keep my mind outside of you. Tell people all the time, free your mind. Matter of fact, In Vogue had a song one time. I believe it was called Free Your Mind. And it said, free your mind and the rest will follow. No truer words have been spoken. You free your mind and the rest is going to follow. So, that's what I do. And, works pretty good for me. Another question was, well, what kind of books do I read? I've read all kinds of books. You know, I must admit that I don't do too much reading anymore, unless I'm in the hole. You know, everybody reads. That's all there is to do in the hole is read. But right now, you know, between the this is a major distraction. It keeps me in my outside world, so I'll do a lot of reading. But some of the books that I've read that I like, just a couple, was Ayanna Van Zandt's, a book called Acts of Faith, 48 Laws of Power, The Art of War. Everybody's read that, The Art of War. And James Patterson, I've read all of his books. And I just got up on an author that I'd never heard of before named Wilbur Smith. I just got up on him a couple years ago. And he's got a ton of books. And the last one I read was a book called Asabi. Excellent, excellent book. I think everybody would like it. Adventure, romance, all mixed together, you know. But mainly adventure. He's a very good writer. I like to read every book he's got out. And, funny, but James Patterson, I've read most every book he has. And, I was in the hole one time, dying for something to read. And I was hollering up and down the hall every day asking people for some books to read. And either they were currently reading them or I had already read them. And this one guy every day, every time I'd ask him, he'd say the same thing. Well, the only book I got is this medieval time book, you know. And I'd be like, nah, I don't want nothing to do with that, you know. I don't want to read no medieval time stuff. And then finally I couldn't find the book, so I told him to send the book over to me. It was a book by James Patterson called The Jester. And that book turned out to be a fabulous, fabulous book. I mean, I couldn't put it down once I started it. But anyway, you know, that's me and my reading. I read the paper when I can. I watch the news every day. Keep up on current events. Somebody asked, have I ever driven a car? And that's actually a good question when you consider how long I've been locked up. But the answer is yes. When I was 14 years old, the only job I've ever had in my real name, I was living in the streets and I got a job at a car lot as a detailer. And I told them I was 17. I'm sure they didn't believe me, but they didn't ask questions because they needed the detail. And they said, you got the job. So what I would do, I would work. And then at nighttime after they close, I would go out in the back corner of the parking lot, and I would get in a car and sleep in a car every night. And I used to make $96 a week. That's how long ago that was. That was minimum wage. And that's how I learned how to drive a car. In the beginning, it was scary because they would take their cars right off the truck when they brand new come in, and I'd have to go park them. And that's how I learned to drive. So, yeah. What is the worst injury I've ever had in prison? From another prisoner. Well, hands down, that would be being stabbed. I've been in a number of knife fights over the years, and I've been stabbed several times. Had to go to outside hospitals and have surgery and stuff. So, that would definitely be the worst injury, being stabbed. How has the food changed over the years? Another guy asks. Well, let me tell you, back in the old days, back in the 70s and 80s, even the early 90s, the food was pretty damn good in here. Everything always depended on what facility you were in, you know, because some facilities took better pride in the food. And some just tried to save as much money and stole as much food as they could. Yeah, back in the old days, on mid midnight shift at night, the lieutenant would back the truck up in the Sally Port gate and go around to the kitchen and load his pickup up. Take all kinds of stuff home with him. But back in those days, the food was good. I mean, we had, like, when we had hamburgers, they'd give you two hamburgers. They had pork chops, you'd get two pork chops. You had liver once a week. You had fried chicken once a week, and they give you two pieces. They had salad bar. They had salad almost every day. French fries. I mean, they just had fabulous good food. And then, you know, as time went on, it started getting worse and worse. And the way it is right now is the worst I've ever seen. I thought it was bad when I first got in receiving. In the hole, they had what they call a soup tank. And if you acted out while you're in the hole, then they put your ass in a soup tank. And a soup tank is just a hole in the middle of the floor and an empty room. And, you know, that's for your bodily functions, of course. And all you got was a bowl of soup twice a day. And it was just like some dirty toilet water or sewer water with a couple pieces of peas and carrot in it. Now, they only kept you in there for 3 days, you know. Then they had to let you out and let you have a regular meal. But that was the worst food I saw back in the old days. And nowadays, I mean, it's just, it's typical. You've seen some of the food, and it's a lot worse than some of the things you've seen now. So it's definitely gotten worse over the years. Somebody else asked, how are the cops nowadays compared to back in the 70s and 80s? Well, man, that's okay. So back in the 70s, first of all, what they did was they strip you of your identity right out the gate. You know, you're not a human being, you're not a man, you're an animal, and they treat you like an animal. So when you went through the receiving center, as soon as you got off the bus and you came and you lined up against that wall and stripped everybody naked, one long line, they made you bend over and spread your cheeks. They look up your booty. And they were quick to call you. If you were black, they either referred to you as boy or nigger. And if you were white, they referred to you as boy. That's how they addressed you. Come here, boy. Get over there, boy. Or if you were black, you know, it was worse. You know, they don't really do that nowadays. But back then, there was unity among the prisoners. The cops were the enemy. You know, it was us against them. And they weren't smart enough back then to try to divide and conquer, you know. But they started out by trying to strip you of your identity and degrade you and dehumanize you. And, you know, they still do some of the same things nowadays, but nowadays, they all they want to do is divide and conquer, you know, so they pit everybody against each other. The police are no longer the enemy. You know, most of these prisons in here now, they want to be friends with the police. And they're always kissing their ass. You know, it makes me sick. It's bad, it really is. And they use the gangs to pit us against each other, you know. Instead of fighting them, they're fighting each other, you know. Ridiculous, but get in the picture. And then here you go, and there's Bob in the picture. The prison toilet.